Hey guys, it's ExandShadow, and this LP is going to be a very special one for me because this game, the one that I'm LPing right now, is one of my all-time favorite games ever. This and Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door are my two favorite games ever created, so this LP holds a special place in my heart already. This is Banjo-Tooie for the Nintendo 64, released November 20th, 2000 in the United States, later on in the other regions. This game was sort of a swan song for the N64 since only a handful of games came out in 2001 before the GameCube came out, and this game just is the pinnacle of that system's achievements. Even then, it was rushed by Rare, so there are still a few technical problems, but even then, this is the pinnacle of N64 gaming. Yeah, the end of an era for the studio, actually, since this was one of the last great games that they ever made. But yes, this is Banjo-Tooie. Just showing you right there, I do have a 100% save file, although I haven't done too many 100% playthroughs before this. This playthrough right here is going to be 100%, so I'm getting every Jiggy, every Cheeto page, every Jinjo, every note, most of the extra hidden stuff. This entire playthrough is going to be as complete as I could make it. So if you want to use this as a walkthrough, go right ahead. I'm going to try to show you the most effective ways to get through the game, ways to cut down on backtracking, convenient ways to backtrack, where hidden stuff is, all that. I love this game so much. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with Banjo-Kazooie, Banjo's first game, well, if you want to count the first appearance he was in, he was a playable character in Diddy Kong Racing. But his first game, Banjo-Kazooie, came out in 1998. And that game was basically considered, and is still to this day considered, sort of a Super Mario 64 1.5 version. And it's a good game. I like Banjo-Kazooie, but the thing is that when I was a kid playing games on my N64 for fun, this game was the one that I played the most. I didn't get to play Banjo-Kazooie until years after I finished Tooie, learned everything in Tooie, played Tooie to death. So I guess due to the nature that I played this first, going to Kazooie is sort of a downgrade. Although I guess there are some things that Kazooie does better, like it definitely runs a little bit more stably, but I still think that overall this game is just the better of the two. However, my technical issues with this game, it's mostly just frame rate and slowdown. There's a lot of frame rate slowdown in this game. And that isn't so much Rare's fault as it is Nintendo's fault, because Nintendo really pushed them to get this out before the N64's last holiday season, so they couldn't polish it quite to the shine that they wanted to. So basically, in the end, they had to choose one thing that had to take a hit, and it was the frame rate. So while it sucks, you know, at least the rest of the game is great enough to make up for it. Like, the frame rate doesn't bother me at all, but then again, that's just due to me having played this game for years and years and years and years. However, I should note that this frame rate issue is only a problem on the N64 version. A couple of years back, Rare released updated versions of this and the first game, Banjo-Kazooie, on the Xbox Live Arcade. And both of these games run amazing on those. I've tried them out a little bit, but the frame rate issues with Banjo-Tooie, absolutely gone in the Xbox version. Which just makes it the best version of the game, because not only is it the same, it's essentially the same amazing game, but it's got the added content with the stop and swap features, which I'll talk about when that becomes relevant here. And also, the frame rate issues are gone, making it run smooth as butter, and that's just awesome. It's times like these where I actually did wish I had an Xbox 360 just so that I could play Banjo-Tooie the way it should have been originally. But anyway, I haven't talked anything about the cutscene going on the screen right now. That's mostly just because the beginning of Banjo-Tooie, although I do like the writing and the story in this game, it just moves a little bit slowly. This is a cutscene, so the text goes at a solid speed, because if I press any buttons, the cutscene will just sort of skip, meaning that it won't, I'll just skip the rest of it. But normally when you're playing the game, you can press the A button to speed up the text so that it goes a little bit faster. So this first cutscene is like 12 minutes long or something ridiculous like that. So it goes on for a while. I won't lie and say that it tends to drag when you're doing repeated playthroughs or when you're trying to commentate over it like I am. But for the first time playing through, I do think that the writing is strong enough to carry the cutscene, so I don't really mind it too much. That's one thing in general that I like better about Tooie than Kazooie, is that the writing and story direction is just better. But I'm going to talk about that more when I want to talk more about the story stuff, because if I use up all my commentary in this first episode, then I'm not going to have anything to say for the rest of the playthrough, and that would be bad, considering that this is a pretty hefty game. It's not, like, obnoxiously long, but especially on your first time through, it could take you probably like 20 to 30 hours to get to the end. I'm able to get through this in like 10 to 12. I don't know how much it ended up being for the playthrough, because I did end up cutting a bit because, you know, you don't need to see pointless backtracking. But the game is a very manageable length, but also a very satisfying length, where it's not so short that it's it's unsatisfying. But it's not so long that you want to tear your hair out and go, when is this going to end, you know? And that's an important thing. It has the right balance, and balance is very important in a game like this. But anyway, I guess I should give you a brief recap of what happened at the first Banjo-Kazooie, since that's a little bit important here. In the first Banjo-Kazooie game, Banjo's sister Tootie was stolen by the evil witch Grunt Tilda. And, well, Banjo went in, kicked ass, and saved Tootie. Oh yeah, that was pretty much it. There really wasn't too much to that plot. I mean, I guess it doesn't really matter what the plot is to a game like this, because it's just sort of an adventure collectathon game, but, you know, it was charming enough, I guess. So anyway, 2 years have passed since the events in that game, and well, Gruntilda has been sitting under that rock for the entire time, and Klungo, her assistant, has been trying to push it over with no luck. You'd think he'd just go to a hardware store and get like a pickaxe or a jackhammer or something, but you know what? Whatever, it's a video game. So, apparently it took Grunty's sisters 2 years to read the fucking obituaries. So they came in and then they got her out from under that rock using magic. Ooh. Even though they do have a giant drill giant drill car, but I guess they just like that because it's cool. You know, not because it's actually effective for drilling through rock, which seems like it would have been a little bit less tiring than using your vaguely defined magic spells, but you know what? Whatever. So, in the meantime, it doesn't seem like Banjo and Kazooie have been doing a whole lot of anything. I mean, yeah, there was that sort of that Game Boy Advance Midquel game that I haven't played, so don't ask me about my opinions on that. But, so yeah, in the meantime, they've just sort of been playing cards, fucking around. And, well, Grunty's sort of pissed at them because they killed her, you know. So now she's going to try to kill them. And Mumbo here is going to try to warn our fair heroes, and try to get them to not die. Oh, that Mumbo. Mumbo actually got a complete design change in between games. He looks, I'd say a little bit more subtle in this game. Like, his design was very loud in Kazooie 1. And in this one, it's a little bit less obnoxious, I think. I personally prefer this design, but then again, that just goes back to the fact that I played this more than the first game, so I'm used to this one as opposed to the other one. The characters definitely have a more active role in this game, because instead of just your standard rescue the princess plot, you know, there's actual stuff going on here. Like, here, Grunty, it's not happening yet, but, you know, this is the sort of thing why talking being a free action is a good thing, because these guys are having like a 5-minute discussion about getting out of the fucking house, and Grunty's over there just casting her 6-second spell. You know, this is exactly how games of Dungeons and Dragons work when I play with a group of friends. It's like, we spend a good 10 minutes designing a plan of battle for when like goblins break into our base or whatever, when in character, it would have taken like, what, 6 seconds for us to come up with this plan, like, through telepathy or some shit. So the same basic thing's happening here. Although Bottles was being stubborn as fuck and he refused to get outside, the fucking moron. So, yeah, that's probably not gonna turn out too good for him, I would guess. So yeah, Well, I guess they're probably up to no good. And they're spawning out bad guys. Wonderful. That's the last thing that Spiral Mountain needed was mooks. Though they never do explain what happened to the vegetables that were just lying around in the first game. I don't know, maybe they just got hungry and decided that gigantic floating vegetables would be good to eat for that afternoon or something. Or maybe they chopped all the floating vegetables with eyes up into a floating vegetable eye salad, and they had that for lunch one day. I'm not sure. Oh, poor Klungo. I love Klungo. Klungo's one of my favorite characters in this game. Actually, I love all the characters in this game, from like the main players to the bit parts, to those sort of in-between roles like Klungo and stuff like that. All the characters in this game make me smile. This game just makes me smile, and that's one of the most important things for any game to do. Like, ear-to-ear smiles are, don't happen an awful lot for me when I'm playing a game. And this game manages to get me to have that ear-to-ear smile every time I turn it on. So that's why I absolutely adore it. Obnoxiously long first cutscene or not. Because, yeah, it's like 10 minutes. And again, I don't mind the cutscene itself. It's a good cutscene, but... You know, at some point I actually just want to start playing the game, and since I've seen it a million times, I usually just skip it when I play just a normal playthrough. But aw shit, she blasted bottles. Well, that sucks. Spoiler alert, he's not surviving that. Yep, death. You heard that right, folks. Nintendo acknowledged death in one of their games. You know, that just made me really sad, because at one point, this was a Nintendo franchise. Like, canonically in the same universe as Mario, even. Also in the same universe as Conker, which makes you kind of think for a moment, but, you know what, whatever. So anyway, this is basically the plot to this game. Just as flimsy, but a little bit more, scaled up, at the very least, you know? It's just basic stop the bad guy sort of narrative, only this time we're doing it for revenge, because that's a good lesson to teach your children. But at least it's better than Save the Princess, you know, a little bit more original, and also a little bit darker too, which I think, it definitely sets the tone for the game, because while this game is still plenty kid-friendly and stuff, it's a little bit darker, like the areas are a little bit more bleak. Colorful, the game is still colorful and happy overall, but it's just not as obnoxiously bright as Kazooie 1. But yeah. Anyway, reason number one why this is one of the best sequels of all time. We have all of our abilities from the first game. Thank you, gaming gods. We have all of our abilities from the first game. Metroid, take notice. Seriously, cut that shit out with your fucking power suit failures. No. This is how you do a sequel. This is how you do it. Anyway, in the first game, Bottles, the guy who just died, gave you a whole bunch of moves, like the ability to fly and jump on things and yada yada yada. In most games, you lose all that shit when you start the sequel, and you have to get it all back. Banjo-Tooie says, fuck you to that tradition, and says, you get to keep all your stuff. You like that stuff, you get to keep it, and we'll just give you more. Good job, game! And they also do the tutorials right too, where if you've played the first game, you can just go on and fight the boss and just play at your own pace. But if it happens to be your first time, all these tutorial mounds are around here that you can look at if you feel like, and then you can learn the moves if you need to. Thank you! This is how you do a sequel! You give people the option to learn if they don't know, if this is their first time, but if they do know, you don't force them through a stupid tutorial section that nobody really wants to play through. Thank you, game! You don't know how great that makes this. I mean, it's a really simple thing, and you'd think that every sequel would do that, you know? Even if it's not this blatant, just a simple thing at the front of the screen. Do you know how to play this? And if you select yes, you can just go on to where the actual game starts and you don't have to deal with any of this bullshit tutorial crap. But, so good. Anyway, that thing we got over there on that cliff was a Cheeto page. I'll explain what those do next time. Now, if you haven't played a Banjo-Kazooie game, the controls are pretty simple, you know, control stick to run, but there's all sorts of different moves that you can use, and I'll try to explain more of them when we get next time, because it's a pretty in-depth control scheme, mostly just because there's so many maneuvers that you can do, but thankfully, everything in the game is really simple. Like, it's either one button or a combination of buttons, and the combinations all make sense. Like, all the combinations that deal with eggs, use like the Z button and stuff like that. So, you know, it's all very simple stuff. I'm sorry, I just got distracted by the cutscene here. I love Klungo, just the way that he talks and he acts. However, Klungo happens to be one of the easiest bosses in video game history. When you play this game, he has three different potions that he can use, which gives him three different possible battle patterns. And you'll fight all three of them over the course of the game, but the order that you get them in every playthrough is randomized. So this one is like the clone potion. So basically, he'll like multiply into clones, and the last one to appear is the real one. So you got to attack that one. You hit him three times, and then he's down. Klungo is a really easy boss, and he's pretty much just there to get you used to the idea of combat in this game. However, his theme song here, Klungo's theme song, is fucking awesome. I love the music in this game. All of the music in this game. One of the best game soundtracks ever. And that's one thing where I will agree, I'm really, really torn between Kazooie and Tooie, is which game has the better soundtrack, because they're pretty much equal in my eyes. Both amazing. But yeah, it took me forever to realize, like years when I looked up the music on YouTube, to realize that Klungo's theme song has a flute section. It's like 2 minutes long, and the fight should never last that long. It's just your very basic boss battle stuff there to get you used to the idea of the game. If you get a different battle there, don't worry, you'll fight it later on, and the same strategy applies every single time you fight the battle, so don't worry, you'll see all three different forms by the end of the game, so don't worry about that. Anyway, next time we are going to get through the last of the cutscenes and continue with our adventure and at full, pretty much. I'm ExandShadow, and I'll see you guys later.